What once seemed like a long delay for Flight 10 is now starting to come to fruition as activity at Starbase ramps up again. Could the next launch be sooner than we thought? On the other hand, SpaceX has successfully launched another rideshare mission, but is having some issues with one of its payloads. Meanwhile, Japan is looking for the cause of the Resilience lunar lander failure, which has finally been found. Let's talk more about it on today's NR Studio episode. The Massey test site incident really slowed down SpaceX Starship program. If it hadn't happened, we might have been preparing for Flight 10 by now. But now all eyes are on cleanup and repairs. SpaceX needs to move quickly to get Starship operations back on track. Fortunately, cleanup began shortly after the explosion on June 20th. The first crane was seen moving into place to help clear debris, which is a good sign that people can safely return to the site. On June 21st, things moved more quickly. Cranes were trying to lift large pieces of debris, but some were so heavy that they had to be dragged. On the 24th, while trying to move a particularly large piece of debris, a crane tipped over. Fortunately, no one was hurt, and there were no major delays. The debris was either loaded onto transport vehicles or set aside for later removal. Images from the Massey test site show that there was a lot of damage. The test stand, nearby tanks, and other buildings were affected by the explosion, so cleanup will likely take days or even weeks. After clearing the debris, SpaceX will need to repair or replace critical systems such as storage tanks, fueling infrastructure, parts of the test stand, and the ship's quick disconnect arm. Only then can they begin testing again at Massey. Despite these challenges, SpaceX is making progress elsewhere at Starbase. On June 21st, two MOVAC tanks were moved to the launch site, and on the 24th, nearly 20 water trucks arrived. It's unclear whether these trucks are for launch pad A or B, but their arrival suggests that Starbase is preparing for further testing or preparing the launch pad. At the production site, things are also moving forward. The hot staging ring is being adjusted back to Mega Bay, where it will likely soon be attached to B-16, which is being prepared for its 10th flight. B-16 is still on schedule, so its next launch could be imminent. Plans for the next Starship flight depend on the status of the new vehicle. With S-36 gone, S-37 will likely replace the 10th flight. S-37 was assembled earlier this year and completed two critical cryogenic tests in late May. That means it's mostly ready for the next step, but there's one major challenge. It hasn't undergone a static fire test. Normally, these tests are conducted at the Massey test site, but that site is currently out of service due to recent issues. Launchpad A has the systems needed for the test, but its setup isn't compatible with the current model of the ship. Launchpad B, meanwhile, is still under construction. The manifold installation isn't complete and requires some individual system testing and a full integration check afterward. This situation could delay the static fire test for S-37 for weeks unless another solution is found or Massey is repaired soon. One bold idea suggests skipping the static fire test altogether. If SpaceX goes that route, they could begin final checks and installation right away, which would include installing the flight termination system, payload adapters, and any mission-specific gear. After completing these steps, the S-37 can be placed on top of the B-16 and moved to the launch site, leading to a full rehearsal to test the system before launch. However, skipping the static firing test can be risky. This test is essential to ensure that everything is working properly, including engine performance and fuel tank integrity. Skipping this step could allow some issues to go unnoticed, especially since the recent S-36 explosion was linked to a failure in the pressure vessel, COPV. While SpaceX has skipped static firing tests before with the Falcon 9, that rocket is a well-established vehicle with a long history of successful flights, making it less risky. Starship, on the other hand, is still in development and has had its fair share of issues on its most recent flights. With all of this in mind, SpaceX has a tough choice going forward. If they trust their systems and believe they have learned from past issues, including the S-36 incident, they may decide to launch without a static firing test. However, if mission success is a priority, they may choose to perform the test first. The main focus is on being well prepared for another launch. SpaceX needs to fix the issues they've recently discovered and thoroughly check everything, from the engines to the fuel tanks, to make sure everything is working properly. This preparation is critical to the success of the mission and to overcoming the challenges they face in the first half of 2025. People are excited to see Starship fly again, especially with increasing competition from China and companies like Honda and Blue Origin. SpaceX needs to show progress to keep up. However, it's important to take the time to prepare well now, because a successful flight will build trust with investors, strengthen relationships with NASA, and help accelerate important missions like Artemis, Starlink deployments, and Mars colonization. Ultimately, SpaceX must find a balance between being ambitious and being cautious. This balance will determine whether Flight 10 is a success or another setback. If you think preparation is the key to moving forward, type "Keep Moving SpaceX" in the comments below. Also, don't forget to like the video and subscribe to our channel to stay updated on Starship and all the latest SpaceX news. Now let's talk about the Falcon 9 Transporter 14 mission. On June 23rd at 5:25 p.m. Eastern Time, SpaceX launched a Falcon 9 rocket from California. The mission, called Transporter 14, was part of a program to carry multiple small payloads into orbit for various customers. Once in orbit, the Falcon 9 second stage released each payload into its designated orbit. Initial reports indicate that the mission was largely successful, confirming the reliability of SpaceX's ride-sharing program. However, not all payloads performed flawlessly. One issue was with the company's re-entry capsule, which ironically calls itself Mission Possible. The capsule, which weighs 1.6 tons and carries 300 kilograms of cargo, was supposed to demonstrate a safe return from space. The capsule separated from the rocket about 2 hours and 45 minutes after liftoff and was intended to land in the North Pacific Ocean. Initially, everything went well. The capsule lit up and began its maneuvers after separation. Unfortunately, after the crash, they lost communication. The company stated there was a problem after that. "We lost communication shortly before landing and are still figuring out what went wrong. We will share more information soon." The company has publicly apologized, saying that the capsule and its payload were likely lost. They said, "We sincerely apologize to all of our clients who trusted us with their payloads. The incident highlights the challenges of space travel, especially when it comes to re-entry and recovery from orbit." It's important to remember that failures like this are common in the aerospace industry. Every test flight carries risks, but it also offers opportunities to learn and grow. The Exploration Company is one of many private organizations working to make space more accessible. This experience will help improve future capsule designs and recovery methods. Overall, the mission highlights SpaceX's important role in bringing things to space through its rideshare program. Companies around the world now have a reliable way to launch their payloads into orbit. While not every mission goes according to plan, success comes from persistence, adaptation, and teamwork. As the space industry continues to grow, we can expect more companies to take on challenges, try new missions, and learn from their experiences. Reaching space is hard, but it can be achieved by those who persist. Now let's talk about Japan's Resilience Lunar Lander. After crashing during its lunar landing, Japanese company iSpace said the problem was caused by a malfunction in the probe's laser rangefinder, which failed to provide accurate altitude data during descent. As a result, the probe was unable to decelerate properly and crashed into the surface near Major Fragoris on June 5th. This is their second failed lunar attempt, following the Hakodor crash in 2023. The exact reason for the laser rangefinder failure is still unclear, but iSpace has suggested four possible causes: unusual surface reflectivity, poor laser angle, weak signal strength, and possibly radiation damage or incorrect descent calculations. In response, iSpace has stepped up testing and upgraded their landing equipment. Their next missions, missions 3 and 4, will use the new Apex 1.0 landers with an improved vision-based landing system to upgrade or replace the old laser rangefinders. Despite these setbacks, iSpace is dedicated to advancing Japan's role in lunar exploration and supporting a long-term human presence on the moon. That's it for today's episode. See you in the next episode, and thank you all for your support.